In the next 10 minutes or so, you will learn about at least 10 legal problems in the mobile space and about at least 10 solutions. Basically, maybe just to jump back one slide, I will concentrate on issues which distinguish mobile games, especially from browser-based games. Some of the issues I'll touch upon will be similar to issues you might know from classical computer or console games, but mostly are pretty much unique to mobile games. The first issue, piracy. Everyone knows about in the PC gaming area. Browser games publishers tend to have forgotten that their colleagues from console games and from PC games face a problem here. So if they venture into the mobile space, they should be aware there is piracy out there, and you can download the files for your gaming apps. For example, on file hosting services, the same file hosting services, which also share pirate copies of classical computer and console games. And it's probably no way to completely prevent this from happening, but it is possible to reduce the problem. One option, of course, is to send out takedown notices, but there are also court decisions who says that a file hoster is responsible for hosted content and that he has to take appropriate measures to prevent this from happening in the future. Again, this will never help to completely prevent it, but it can reduce the problem, at least for file hosters based in, let's say, European countries, such as Germany or Switzerland, which again, is not everything, but they have quite a big market share anyway. So you have to be aware of the problem and you can do something against it. Second issue, again, something which browser games companies are not very familiar with, that's modding. Modding, that is modification of your gaming app by players, by the fans. And this can be nice because it can help to broaden your fan base, to make your customers more loyal. But unfortunately, it might be a problem if the modification of your app concerns your payment features or your premium features. So you have to be a little bit cautious here. The third issue would be technical issues. And here we have really something which is unique to the mobile space. You have a lot of handsets, you have upgraded operating systems. And as far as the iOS space is concerned, you have a very limited number of handsets, but still you get new hardware from time to time and you get a new operating system from time to time. This gets, of course, more complicated for Android. New issues would be what happens if a new generation comes out. The one thing you have to take care for is your developer contracts. They shouldn't be fixed to the current version, but you also should consider the next generation for handsets and for operating system. And for example, what happens with achievements of the users or even of paid content the user has acquired for a game, and if the user upgrades to a new handset, should this be transferable? Probably the user will expect that he can take the paid content to his new hardware. you might not be so sure that he has the right to do so. So there's no case law on it. If you don't want to allow the user to take the paid content to the next hardware, you should at least insert a clause like that in your terms of conditions. Not sure if it holds, but it's better than nothing. Or you should make sure that it's possible. Mobile games are distributed in a very different way. Classical computer games or browser-based games. So far, most of the apps are purchased in the App Store, and there's a stiff competition in the App Store. So app developers and publishers do almost anything to get up in the ranking, to get natural traffic on the app, not just pay traffic. So one thing which happens is, let's say, app descriptions, which have third-party brand names in. This would be more or less what happened in the internet with meta tags, or with like everything you did, or which was done a couple of years ago to get on top of Google rankings. Probably very often violating third-party trademarks. Then you have like funny names like Battle Duty, Modern Field. I think for most people this links something, or quite a lot of stuff, Call of Duty, Battlefield, Modern Warfare. There might be trademark issues when naming your app. And also very popular is paid recommendations. User gets free in-app content or whatever if he gives your app a good rating. The app stores are not always as neutral as they seem to be to the user. And can this all be legal? Probably not. There are IP rights existing also in mobile space, and they can be enforced even easily. In fact, even easier than in the normal online world, because they can be enforced through the courts, for example, as injunctive relief, national courts, which is granted usually within a couple of days, but also through the app stores. You can send a takedown notice, for example, to Apple. And if your IP rights are infringed upon, you have good chance that the app of your competitor is pulled. So it's taken out of the app store. So you have at least two tracks how to deal with infringement. You should review your contracts and not just take the contracts you already have from browser games or console games. When talking about contracts, I'm talking about user contracts, which would be the terms of service or EULAs, which might have to be adapted slightly. Then there would be the contract between the publisher and the developer, which basically is a pretty much standard development contract. Still, you have to take into account the relation to, for example, Apple. So it's essential that a developer complies with Apple's guidelines, or else you end up with an application which cannot really be distributed. You have to take into account, as I mentioned earlier, new versions of the operating system and new generation of handsets. And you might even think about if acceptance of your app is linked to acceptance in the App Store. That's something we know from console games, where usually you need to pass at least a log check to have the game approved. And always keep in mind the contract you have with the App Store, because it has a huge impact of the app which you develop. for youth protection. In Germany, it pretty much follows the same rules as online youth protection, but you might have a better chance to actually work with the time limits. An online distribution, the time limits, so only sending or making available games for 16 plus or 18 plus. At nighttime works just for downloads of games. It doesn't work for browser-based games, for example. For the distribution of apps, this might be a viable solution. Facebook. Think twice if you really can allow Facebook to access the user's contacts, for example, or your own app. So you might run into data protection issues. For example, geotargeting. Your geolocation would be considered to be personal data, at least by the data protection authorities. And the Article 29 working group has, that's from data protection authorities in Europe, they have special requirements for geo data. And for example, they want you, that the user renews the consent once a year. Not sure whether that's really a legal requirement, but it would be considered something like a best practice. Okay, it's not a US ID, of course, it should be a UDID or any other kind of unique identifier of the device. There's a debate whether that's personal data. That's running pretty much along the same lines than whether IP addresses are personal data or not. So the data protection authorities hold that the unique identifier is personal data. And Apple, for example, tends to be pretty strict about the use of the UDID recently. So that's an issue for data protection. So it's better to have an identifier of just your app and not of the device, which in most cases will serve for the same purpose. And then we have like at least for the iOS world, we have a huge gatekeeper issue, because basically what happens if Apple pulls the plug and your app disappears, it's commercially dead. And there are antitrust law restricting Apple, but just be aware that it might be difficult or long road to enforce them. So if you want to be on the safe side, you should closely monitor what Apple does or intends to do. And well, I just gave you 9 slides, not 10, but I think I had more than 10 legal problems on my 9 slides.